Northside. My name is Hannah Manali, and I'm the Children's Ministry Director here, and we just want to welcome you to our online service. We have a lot of really exciting announcements today, so I hope you are ready. But first, let's talk about the connection card. We always love getting a connection card from you, so head on over to our website and fill one out. It's a great way for us to get to know you, answer any questions, and most importantly, to pray for you. So if you have any prayer requests, please head on over and fill one of those out. And also, if you would like to give to what the Lord is doing here at Northside, there is also an online giving option on our website, and we are just so grateful for your extreme generosity. So it is official. We are moving our services to the morning and indoors on August 1st at Oak Grove. There will be an email going out soon with more details about this, but mark your calendars. Just 2 weeks from now, we are going to be moving to the morning at 10 a.m. and indoors at Oak Grove. So, related to this, some super exciting things coming down the pipe here for kids ministry. We are going to be starting our two youngest classes, nursery and preschool, on that same date, August 1st. So nursery is 0 to 24 months and preschool is ages 2 to 4. Those are going to be kicking off 10 a.m. August 1st. So with this only being 2 weeks away, we have a huge need for more volunteers for our kids ministry. So it could just be once or twice a month. Anything from holding babies to doing the hokey pokey with preschoolers to doing Bible skits with our elementary school kids and everything in between. We have a huge need and a place for you if that's something that you're interested in. We're also looking for somebody to help with our check-in system at the beginning of the service, right when parents are checking their kids in, someone to just kind of man those computers and help parents get their kids checked in. So if any of this interests you at all, or if you just want to know more before committing, please email me. My email is hannah@northside-albany.com, and I look forward to hearing from you. The second thing relating to our kids ministry is that we have some events planned for this summer that we are calling Popsicles in the Park, which is an awesome opportunity for you guys to just get to know other kids ministry families and hang out and eat popsicles in the park. So our first one is planned for this Wednesday, the 21st at 6:30 p.m. at North Albany Park. We planned the time that's hopefully late enough for working parents to join, and then also early enough for little ones that need to get to bed that they can join too. So we have a second one in August, August 18th at 6:30 at Gibson Hill Park. So come hang out, meet new families, and feel free to bring friends as well. The next announcement is that on the night of August 29th, which is a Sunday, this is a slight date change, from 5 to 8:30, we are hosting a luau at Oak Grove. This is going to be a fun, huge community event that we are inviting North Albany to, and we just really hope to use it as an outreach. So we ask that you invite friends and neighbors to come on out. We're gonna have a lot of super fun things at that event. So save the date, August 29th from 5 to 8:30. And then lastly, on August 8th, Val Lamilo will be coming from Uganda. She's one of the missionaries that Northside supports, and she is going to be coming and speaking to us at 10 a.m. on August 8th, so you won't want to miss that. All right, let's head into a time of prayer before we start the service. Oh, Lord, we just want to come before you right now and pray for just small business owners here in our community who are likely still struggling from the pandemic. And we just pray that they would be able to recover, Lord, and that you would even just show us ways that we could support small local businesses around here, Lord. And we also want to pray for our small group ministry and their leaders, Dana and Robin Penner, just that you would give them wisdom and direction as they work to just launch our small group ministry this fall, Lord, and that you would just encourage them, as I know it's been hard not being able to have this ministry going for the whole last year. And Lord, we just look forward to all the connections that are going to be made through those small groups, Lord. And lastly, we want to pray for another church in our area, Hope Church, and their pastor, Mark Robinson, as they just serve and reach out to this community as well, Lord, and that you would help us to encourage them and come alongside them and just really be united with them as we together reach this area. So Lord, we just pray that you'd prepare our hearts for your word and that you would just bless this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Bye, guys.
Good evening, Northside, and all the people walking in. Good to see you all. Hey, if you're able to, let's stand together. Lord Jesus, we are thankful to gather in your name. What a privilege it is and huge honor to seek you and to proclaim the goodness of who you are. And God, as we stand here, we just want to honor you, and we want to come before you with rejoicing and with thanksgiving and gratitude for all that you've done. God, there's so many things that are hard to deal with in our lives, so many things that are difficult, ways things are going wrong. Whether it's in our own homes or whether it's in the world. God, that doesn't change. That you're still working all things together for the good. And we trust you. Help us to praise you with our whole hearts now. In Jesus' name, amen. Who am I that the highest King would welcome? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Oh yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, who is free. Child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Chosen, not forsaken. Say I am. You are for me, not against me. Oh, I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. Oh, I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Who the Son set free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God, yes I am. 'Cause you're a good, good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Thank you. searching for answers far and wide, but I know that we're all searching for answers only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say your word. You're a good, good Father. You're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Oh, you are perfect in all of your ways. Oh, you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect. God, thank you that you are so good. I pray, God, we would respond to your goodness, that we would hear your word, and that we would open our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Y'all can be seated.
Welcome, Northside family. What a beautiful evening. Thanks for joining us. And those of you online, thank you for joining us as well. My name is Brandy, and this is my husband, Jamie. We just want to say thanks for coming, and we have a few announcements for you this evening. We start out with, we've got in your bulletins, if you're here in person, there's a welcome card we would love for you to fill out. It's just an opportunity for you to ask questions or give us some prayer requests. We'd love to pray for you. It's just a way for us to get to know you better. So we'd really appreciate that. And if you would like to give financially to the work of the Lord here at Northside, there is an offering box over where you first came in, or you can give online on the website, northside-albany.com. And I think that's it for me.
I also wanted to remind you that today is the last day to sign up for our golf tournament. It's the first annual invitational, golf invitational for Northside Church. This is my buddy Gary Eaton. Will you raise your hand, Gary? He's kind of been putting this all together. Would you help me say thanks to him for that? Such a good thing. appreciate Gary. He called me with this idea, and I'm like, yes, you should do that. And today is the last day to sign up for that, and pay. And so if you haven't paid, today's the day. If you haven't signed up and want to, today's the day. You can do that by talking to Gary. If Beth is here, I thought I saw her. You can talk to Beth and Dan Austin. I saw him. Dan's way back there. And so if you have any questions or if you need to pay or whatever, those are the people you're looking for. I got to go golfing with Jonathan Powell. He's my witness. On the second shot on a par four hole, I got it within like 5 feet. So miracles happen. It's like I'm really bad. And so anyway, if you want to sign up for our golf tournament, those are the guys that you want to talk to. The tournament itself is on the 24th at 2 p.m. It's $25 if you don't want a cart. It's $35 if you do want a golf cart. It's 9 holes. It comes with a meal and a small gift bag. Sounds like a whale of a deal. So I hope you'll join us.
Yes. And I just wanted to add to that some friends of mine that I was playing volleyball with last night at the movie night, we decided our next tournament should be volleyball tournament because there's some ladies that have some mad skills, right? So we thought that might be fun. We'll see. We'll keep you updated. So middle school and high schoolers, most of them are already back meeting at youth group. But so parents and those of you online, there is a lake day planned coming up. August 7th, they're going to spend the day at the lake just wakeboarding and tubing and water skiing, and there's food, and the cost is $20, but don't let that hold you back. If $20 is something you can't come up with, we can help you out. Just let us know. But Jim Atkins is our contact person for that, so you can talk to him after service, or you can find his phone number or email on the website as well.
Good. Yeah, they've got a few boats lined up to go. It's going to be at Foster Lake. It's going to be a really great time. So that's August 7th, and hopefully they can make it. The last thing that I need to let you guys know is that some things in the school district have been kind of cattywampus for the last little bit. And I got a phone call on the Thursday, basically had to make some pretty hard decisions for the church over the course of about 24 hours, reached out to the management team, reached out to the staff. And I just want to let you know that they're like... this isn't 100%, but I want to let you know as soon as we can. I expect to know early next week whether this is going to be reality or not. But it does look like the beginning of August, so the first Sunday in August, we will be moving to 10 a.m. and we will be indoors. And it could be a great thing. I mean, I love being out here, and I love sometimes meeting in the evening in the summer. I really do. There's just a lot going on right now, and the school district has been so great at trying to work with us. I so appreciate the people that I get to work with. We just had to make a really hard decision, and that was, I think, the best decision we had. And so I will let you know next week for sure, but I just wanted to let you know so you can start adjusting, because I know for some of you that, you know, like haul trailers and stuff like that, the earliest heads up we can give you, probably the better. So take that with a grain of salt. The other thing that I want to let you know that is in that is things will be kind of progressing gradually. So if we meet indoors that Sunday, the first Sunday in August, we won't have like a full-blown children's ministry. We just aren't ready for that. But we probably will have something, and then we'll kind of continue to build up into the point where on the 12th, which we're still going to see as Northside's big relaunch, then everything will be up and running. So come the 12th, that's the goal, and we're going to be building up to that till that point. So you can be praying for that, because there's a lot of work, a lot of things in motion between here and there, but that's kind of what it's looking like. And with that, would you pray with us? And so, God, we just want to take a minute to pray and to say thank you for all the ways that you bless us. And, God, if we were to today sit here and really try to imagine all the different ways that you have shown your kindness and your goodness, the ways that you've blessed us, if we were to go down to every little thing that you do, God, to the air that we breathe, to the way that our eyes see, to the way that we, have a roof over our head, God, we could not exhaust that list in a day. And so we just want to take time to say thank you for all that you do. God, we want to say thanks for Jim Atkins, our youth director, and all the work that he's done trying to put some stuff together for students in a time where getting stuff together for students has been incredibly difficult. I know that he's got a couple of big things on his radar, the Lake Day, and there's another thing potentially in August that's coming. And so, God, I just pray for our youth ministry here at Northside. I'm thankful that we have some stuff on the radar. Thankful for those who volunteer there. God, we just ask for your blessing over the youth department, and man, thank you so much.
Yes, Lord, thank you. You are so good and so gracious to us. Thank you for all the ways that you provide. God, tonight we are specifically thankful for the firefighters and EMTs that serve our community so well. Thank you for them. And we just want to lift them up to you and ask for your safety and protection over them. And just pray for blessing and guidance and wisdom as they do their jobs.
Yeah, God, and we want to pray for a church that has been a supporting church for Northside since early on. We think of Oregon City Christian Church, and I just thank you for their support, for the way that they pray for us. And God, I pray that you would show us ways that we can be a real encouragement to them as well.
Yes, Lord, I also want to lift up another church in our community, South Albany Community Church, and their pastor, John Kahn. Lord, thank you for them and their service to our community and their love to the people here, and I just pray for blessing over them, over Josh and their congregation. I just pray for protection and for guidance over them, and just show us ways that we can connect with them and partner with them and encourage them. And we just lift all this up to you in our service this evening, and may you be glorified through every bit of it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, thank you guys for coming this evening. Like my wife mentioned, my name is Jamie. I'm the lead pastor here at Northside, and it's always great to be with you guys, whether here in person or online. I really do enjoy it. I'm tempted to not put my sermon notes down because I have a feeling they're going to end up somewhere else. But I have a feeling that I'm not the only one. I'm sure that you guys have had experiences in life where, like, either right after it happened or soon after it happened, like, you're able to step back in all the wisdom that you have and say, that wasn't smart. For those of you who know me well, you know that I'm not stretching the truth at all when I say I actually have lots of stories like that. I kind of grew up that way. In fact, I thought that I grew up, when I was growing up, I thought I was a pyrotechnic. It just turns out that I'm just a pyro of a general variety. But I thought that I was, like, you know, good with explosions and stuff. And, literally I did. At one point I did set my sister's carpet on fire with a light bright. That really happened. And I have all kinds of stories about explosions that I may or may not have been a part of, but I definitely was. Things like garbage cans that don't exist, and things like old abandoned cars out in the middle of Central Oregon that, yeah. And there's even one story, particularly bad story, about an elk carcass that I decided to blow to smithereens. And I'll be honest, that was one of those ones that as soon as it went off, I realized that was not smart. I mean, it was no exploding well. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? Oregon coast exploding well. You guys remember how the anchor for the news, that was the funniest thing, the way the anchor man for the news was going about it. He's like, the blast blasted blubber beyond all believable bounds. And I'm like, come on, man. Like, that was too funny. But there's bits of well everywhere. It actually, one of the bits, ended up crushing the hood of the car. And then immediately they start interviewing the head of the guy. And he's like, well, I thought 3 tons of dynamite would have done it or something. I'm like, oh, man. Like, kind of jealous and kind of embarrassed all at the same time, you know? But those moments in life where you step back and say, gosh, that wasn't smart. It was a handful of years ago, 6 or 7 years ago, maybe more, I don't remember. I was helping tear down a building, and I looked at one of my friends, and I said, hey, do you know if the power's off? And he looked at me with this weird face, he kind of smiled a little bit, and then he walked over to the wall, and he grabbed a bare wire that was sticking out of the wall, and as soon as he touched it, I could tell by the look in his eye what the answer was, right? And I'm such a bad person because, when stuff like that happens, I laugh. And I know that I shouldn't. I know that it's not okay and that it's probably not godly, but I do. I laugh. And in this particular time, it was extra bad because he made that noise. You know what I'm talking about, right? As soon as he touched it, he made that noise, and I couldn't stop laughing. I'm trying to hide my face from him. I felt horrible. I think he may have lost a fingernail. And despite what you're thinking, no, that wasn't James. But that's a true story. I felt horrible, and the guy literally was missing his index finger fingernail, and man, yeah, that wasn't smart. We're in the third week of a sermon series that we're doing on the book of Proverbs, and the book of Proverbs was written by a guy named Solomon, and really, if you were to sum up the theme of Proverbs in a word, it's wisdom, and so that's why we're calling the sermon series Get Smart. And if you're anything like me, that means, you might be able to apply it too. Godly wisdom. It's not just any wisdom. It's godly wisdom. And if you learn anything about what Proverbs is trying to teach, that godly wisdom is something that you just can't compete with in any other way. I mean, if God really is the creator of it all, if God really is the sustainer of it all, godly wisdom isn't going to be matched by any other thing. You're not going to be able to top it yourself or read it in a book. Godly wisdom is in a category all of its own. And I mentioned this on week one. I've been in ministry a long time, and the truth is, as I kind of just think about this topic, and the truth is, I just don't feel like folks desire godly wisdom anymore. I don't hear it as being something that people really pray for or desire in their life or seek to really apply to their life the way that maybe one time I remember hearing. And so this idea of godly wisdom, one of the questions that we back up and ask is that where you're at? Is godly wisdom something that you really think is a good thing? Is it something that you pray for? Is it something that you want to apply to your life? Do you really believe that would make a difference in your life? Seeking and applying godly wisdom leads to all kinds of good things in your life. That's one of the major themes of Proverbs. But it's not just there. It's all throughout the Scripture. Applying godly wisdom to your life leads to all kinds of good things. And you'll never exhaust it. When it comes to learning godly wisdom and applying godly wisdom to your life, you'll never exhaust it. You'll never come to the place where you'll be able to stand up and throw your arms up and say, yes, I finally did it. You'll be growing in godly wisdom for the rest of your life. Godly wisdom changes things. In fact, its intent is to change things. And that's one of the things that Solomon points out for you and I. In fact, one of the ways that Solomon points us out to us is he uses three caricatures throughout the book of Proverbs. And they do go at times by other names. But you can boil those names down to just a couple, like the three things, the fool, the simple, and the wise. So when I came up with that, I thought I was like super ingenious, but then I started reading more on Proverbs. People have been using that analogy for years, so it's not anything unique with me. But three caricatures that you see in the book of Proverbs is the fool, the simple, and the wise. And he uses them in such a way, like these caricatures, so that it's really easy to identify. It doesn't take, you know, a degree to identify what he's talking about or who he's talking about. And I think partially the reason why Solomon does that is so that not only can we identify easily who he's talking about, but he also does that so that we can easily identify with those people, right? Which I'll dive into here in a bit. And so when it comes to the fool, I'm going to go ahead and indulge you a little bit with some of the passages that Solomon uses to help us identify who he's talking about when he's talking about foolish people. Because some of the ways that Solomon goes after that, well, you'll see, it's good. One of the things, like when it comes to the fool, it's one who steadily opposes God, or at least the wisdom of God. And Proverbs suggests that these, like when it comes to the foolish people, like they're not just outside the four walls of the church. Actually, some of them go to church, is the way he makes it sound. And so one of the things that Solomon says is that that foolish people are hard to honor. Proverbs 26:8 says that honoring a fool is as foolish as tying a rock to a slingshot. Anyone try to do that? Right? So you can hear that, right? Honoring a fool is as hard as trying to tie a rock to a slingshot. The foolish people don't apply wisdom, and they end up bringing pain upon themselves. Proverbs 26:9 says that a proverb in the mouth of a fool is like a thorny branch that's being brandished by a drunkard. Solomon goes on to say that they often resist for God's forgiveness, that they're bankrupt and dangerous in their influence and on their impact of others. They cause grief to those that love them. They're often lazy. They betray relationships and struggle with truth. They often repeat their mistakes over and over and over again. Proverbs 26:11 says that just like a dog returns to its vomit, so a fool often repeats his folly. And just like that, we all became cat people. Just kidding, gross. Sorry, if you're a cat person, I'm not. But anyway, and yet this is the thing that really stuck out to me. More than any other thing, the thing that really stuck out to me is this, right? When it comes to foolish people, there's a passage in Proverbs 26:12 that helps us to understand that they're not beyond hope. That they're not beyond hope. 26:11 says, Proverbs 26:12 says that though there is more hope for fools than for those people who think that they're wise. There's more hope for fools than those who think they're wise. And so even those who are living outside of God's wisdom and who are struggling with things, one of the things that God wants us to know that he told us through Solomon is that there's hope. You're not beyond the grip of hope. And I hope that you know that. I hope that you understand that. I'll talk more about that in a minute. And then Solomon goes on to talk about the simple, and really I think what he means by that is he's talking about those who aren't firmly committed to God or to God's wisdom. They're a bit of a floater. They're unstable. they kind of get pushed back and forth by their own feelings and emotions and by culture and by public opinion. And maybe one of the biggest issues, I think, when it comes to the simple is that they just kind of simple, they're simply sort of coasting or refusing to invest, or at best, refusing to invest in the discipline that brings real godly growth in their lives. So they're just kind of standing back and letting life happen to them. They're not investing in searching out for godly wisdom or applying it to their life. Proverbs 14:15 says that simpletons believe everything, simpletons believe everything that they're told, but the prudent carefully consider their steps. They make the most out of every opportunity. In the very first chapter of Proverbs in verse 4, Solomon says that these proverbs give insight to the simple. And one of the things that Solomon kind of infers to, you kind of have to read into a bit, but I do think this is what he means in chapter 1, verse 22, where he basically says that those who linger in this area of the simple, who kind of coast through life and they set their camp up there, they kind of continue in that process of just floating through life, basically makes it sound like you're on the edge of becoming foolish. Like you're on, that's the trajectory of being foolish, is to live in this, the area of the simple and stay there. And then he's, you know, another thing that he talks about is the wise. And so some of the things that he says about the wise is that they trust God. They're humble. They listen to the counsel of the wise. They don't surround themselves with fools. They learn to hear and recognize and apply God's wisdom to their life. They leave an example that's worth following. They don't put themselves in environments that rob them of real life. They are disciplined. They have a healthy fear of God. And they don't lean on their own understanding. And I think what God is communicating through Solomon is not just to help us to understand the distinction between like the wise, the simple, and the fool. I think he's trying to help us to understand the outcome of those. Like, where do those things really lead us in life? And I'll be honest, so as I was like reading through Proverbs and I had those three caricatures in mind, because I do think this is partially how we read Proverbs. Is we understand, when we read through Proverbs, like we kind of try to read it through the lens of the wise and through the lens of the simple and through the lens of the fool. And as you read through the book of Proverbs with those things floating in the back of your mind, it was really interesting for me. Because it does kind of change the lay of the way it reads a little bit. And to give you an example of that, we're going to dive in to that in just a minute. When it comes to that area of the wise and the fool and the simple, one of the things that I'd ask is like I couldn't encourage you enough to dive into that with like brutal transparency and honesty with yourself and ask the question, like, do you see yourself in any one of those? If you're like me, the answer to that is yes, actually all of them. There are areas of my life where I feel like I fit into every single one of those categories where I'm not where I should be. There's other areas where I am sort of floating and I'm not exactly where I ought to be. And then there's other areas where I feel like God has blessed me with enough wisdom, at least, you know, that I'm growing in that. And so I see myself in every single one of those things. Over and over again, God comes back to this idea in Proverbs, but not just in Proverbs, everywhere else in Scripture, and that the godly wisdom well applied brings good things to you and to those around you. And it reminds me of a passage that we read about in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 15 and 16 that says this. It says, "See, I set before you today life and prosperity, death and destruction. For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, and to keep his commands, decrees, and laws." As I was thinking about that today with the passage that we're going to look at here in a minute and try to understand the caricatures that we see in the book of Proverbs, this idea of God setting before us life and death, prosperity, even though I don't think that word prosperity might mean exactly what we think it means sometimes in this context. But prosperity and destruction. And it seems to me like the key factor, the differentiating factor in all of this is it comes to like how we handle what it is that we hear when it comes to godly wisdom. Do we hear it? Do we obey it? Do we apply it to our life? Do we invest in it? Am I a fool? Am I simple? Or am I wise? The answer I found was yes. And to help you kind of understand that, we're going to look at a passage in Proverbs chapter 4, verses 20 through 27. And as I read that, do your best to try to hear that through the lens of those three caricatures, kind of asking yourself, like, how does this, what does this look like for these three different people? And see if you find yourself somewhere in the mix. So Proverbs 4, 20 through 27, here's what it says. "My child, pay attention to what I say. Listen carefully to my words. Don't lose sight of them. Let them penetrate deep into your heart, for they'll bring life to those who find them and healing to their whole body. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Avoid all perverse talk. Stay away from corrupt speech. Look straight ahead. Fix your eyes on what lies before you. Make out a straight path for your feet. Stay on the safe path. Don't get sidetracked. Keep your feet from following evil. I read that passage a bunch this week, and I tried to evaluate it from those three caricatures. There's one verse in that set of verses that just kept sticking out to me over and over and over and over again. It's in verse 23 where Solomon says, "Above all else, guard your heart." Above all else, guard your heart. And I'm not sure that we talk about that enough as a church. I'm not sure that we talk about that enough with our students. I'm not sure that we talk about that enough with our kids and with our grandkids, to guard our hearts. If you were to look into the English Standard Version at the same verse, this is how they translate it. It says to keep your heart with all vigilance. To me, that helps you understand the point that this intentional, consistent, diligent, sacrificial approach to the protection of the condition of your heart. And if you really study that out, the best thing that I could come up with is that it's very, very similar to actually hiring like an armed guard. To hire an armed guard whose sole duty is to protect the condition of your heart. So I feel like Solomon is saying, like when he's saying to guard your heart, he's using that sort of language, like to go to that extent. We're protecting our heart to that degree. And when we read this passage, I think that it assumes a couple of things that are really healthy for us to think about. One is that our heart will be, or maybe currently is, under attack. That there is battles, or that there will be, or that there are battles that are going on over our heart. And if I were to be totally transparent with you, I would say, like, if we look around at the world that we live in and we cannot see that happening all around us, we are in big trouble. So there is, or there will be, battles going on for your heart. The other thing that I think Solomon sort of just like assumes, or hopes that we assume in this passage, is that your heart is worth fighting for. Above all else, guard your heart, for it determines the course of your life. You hear that, right? You hear that. Guard your heart. Why? Solomon says, because it determines the course of your life. Again, the English Standard Version says, "For from it flow the springs of life." For from it flow the springs of life. Man, that sounds huge. One author that I read said it like this, that everything that we do is a manifestation. It kind of brings to life those things that are in our heart. It's a reflection of the reality of our heart, the condition of our heart. What we say and how we act and how we spend our time, even how we spend our money, is a reflection of the reality of what's going on inside of our heart, what's happening in our heart. And again, God is using Solomon to teach us something that Jesus taught regularly. He taught often. In Luke 6, 43 through 45, Jesus said this, "A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. A tree is identified by the fruit that it produces. Figs are never gathered from thorn bushes, and grapes are never picked from bramble bushes. A good person produces good things from the treasury, or the stored upness of things in his good heart, and an evil person produces evil things from the treasury or the storehouse of an evil heart." What you say flows from what's in your heart. And Jesus is saying that the stuff comes out of our life. That what we say and what we do, it's a reality of what's going on in our heart. And so cultivating our heart, guarding our heart, is exactly how Solomon made it sound. It's incredibly impactful. It's incredibly important. Even on the Sermon on the Mount, that's one of the major things. The Sermon on the Mount is Matthew 5 through 7. It's the best sermon that's ever been preached. Jesus himself preached it. But one of the major themes of the Sermon on the Mount, in my opinion, is right there, that what goes on in your heart matters. It matters. I honestly feel like Jesus points out again and again and again that how our actions are actually sort of symptomatic of what's going on in our heart, and that's why he cares about it so much. One of the things that Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, that it's not about just about the act of adultery. Yeah, he doesn't want us to do that. But it's about having lust in our heart and letting it find its home in us. He uses the word, he uses the example of murder. And it's like, yeah, no, God doesn't want us to do that. But it's not just about murder, but it's about letting hate and anger find its home in your heart. One author that I read mentioned it like this. He said that it's our culture has become increasingly obsessed with symptomatic treatments, that we often don't deal with the real issue, but only the behavior. And it reminds me of what God was speaking to us through Jeremiah, Jeremiah 6:14, where he says they in this passage refers to religious leaders. He says that they offer superficial treatments to my people's mortal wound. The spiritual leaders of that day were offering superficial treatments to God's people's mortal wounds, assuring them of peace when there was no peace. Sin is a heart issue. And that's why Jesus spent so much time addressing heart issues. And it needs to be dealt at the heart level. It's not just behavior modification. God cares far more about the condition of your heart. The springs of life come from your heart. Your heart determines the course of your life, your words, your actions, your convictions, your thoughts. It's a major theme because Jesus knows that whatever grips your heart, it forms and informs and drives, becomes apparent in what we do and in who we're becoming. It can lead to captivity or it can lead to healing. It can lead to life or it can lead to brokenness. Guarding your heart, although we don't talk about it near enough as a church, is incredibly important. Warren Wiersbe said it like this, that if we pollute the wellspring of our heart, the infection will spread and our hidden appetites will become open sin, which will become open shame. And most treacherous of all is when we lose sight of shame itself. It's so important, the course of your life, the impact that it has on you and those around you. Your heart is worth protecting. And as I was writing this, one of the things I just kept kind of like in my soul, like just kind of kept like, if I were to look every single one of you ladies in the face, I wish I could right now, look every single one of you in the eye, and I would say, your heart is worth guarding. I want you to know that. Your heart is worth guarding. And it may not be quite as couth or cool to say, but I would look at the men in the face, every single one of you, and I would say that your heart is worth guarding. Your heart is worth guarding. So how do we do that? How do we get to the point where we're living life and we're guarding our heart because we realize the impact that it could have? And one of the things that I read in my study is probably the first step is always to pray about it. So pray that God would give you the wisdom on how to guard your heart. Another thing that one of the people I read said that we have to, another important step is acknowledging the deceptive power of our heart. That the pronation to be driven by feelings and emotion and even selfish motivation, we have to realize what it is that we're up against. Another thing that God said through Jeremiah is that above all else, our heart is deceitful. And the Bible warns us about being double-hearted or proud-hearted or having an unbelieving heart or a cold heart or an unclean heart. Left to our own devices, our hearts are deceitful enough that the Bible actually uses the phraseology of giving us, like God giving us a new heart. And he's not talking about a heart transplant. And in fact, I would tell you that I think that God uses similar language in other parts of the Bible to help us understand exactly what it is that he's talking about. Early on in the book of John, it talks about this guy Nicodemus who came to Jesus in the middle of the night. And one of the things that Jesus told Nicodemus was that you must be born again. And Nicodemus didn't know what to make of that. He's like, that just sounds weird. I'm going to tell you up front. And he was talking about a new heart. Like a new heart that brings about a new life in such a way that it actually radically changes your life. Changes your life in such a powerful way so that those who knew you before would have a hard time recognizing who you are. Was not a Christian all through high school. Ended up in a Bible college even though I wasn't a Christian. There are still people in my hometown that do not believe that I do what I do. I go home and I sometimes see people in high school and they find out, literally, my dad ended up working with one of my friends like 15, 20 years later. And when my dad told him what I did for a living, he literally laughed in my dad's face until he realized my dad was serious. Radically changes your life to the point where you're almost unrecognizable. Centered on Jesus and growing in our ability to apply godly wisdom that brings real and lasting change in our life. It's funny because if you start to pull apart the passage that we read, Proverbs 4, 20 through 27, it is right in the middle, this part about guarding your heart, but it's surrounded by these other guarding kinds of things, right? And it's funny because they all sort of work together. So verse 20 through 22 talks about being vigilant or guarding our ears. Being vigilant with our ears, being biblically attentive and listening and applying God's wisdom, the wisdom that God left for you in His Word. And one of the things that I want you to know, you'll hear it from me often, you've heard it from me before, but there is no substitute for God's Word in your life. I don't think that you'll ever find godly wisdom without it. It's centered on believing that God's Word is actually profitable for you. It's centered on this idea of believing that God's Word is actually profitable for life. I believe that part of guarding your heart means filling it with God's truth. Verse 24 talks about being vigilant with your mouth. In Matthew 15, 11, Jesus was talking with religious leaders, and he basically said, reminded them, you know what, that what goes into your mouth is not what defiles you. It's what comes out of your mouth that defiles you. It protects, or it projects the reality of our hearts. And being vigilant with our mouth, it's one of the ways that we guard our heart. I don't know if you're like me, but I'm assuming that I'm not that weird. Like, sometimes when I'm around people and I don't necessarily guard my mouth very well, it's weird what follows sometimes. Like when you let your guard down and you just kind of let it go, right? Sometimes other things kind of follow suit. And I feel like one of the things that Solomon, God through Solomon, is telling us is that guarding your mouth actually will play a role in guarding your heart. Verse 25 talks about being vigilant with our eyes, or guarding our eyes, fixing our eyes on where we're going, meaning on the path that leads to Jesus. Not looking to the left or to the right. It's like having a godly vision for your life and being disciplined toward it. And one of the things that Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 6, verse 22, is this, that your eye is like a lamp that provides light for your body. When your eye is healthy, your whole body will be healthy. And again, those things that we allow our eyes to fall on impact the way that we think. It's formative. They've been saying that for years. Guard your eyes. Verse 26 and 27 talks about being vigilant with your feet, or guarding your path, being purposeful in your path. And one of the things, the most helpful things that I could tell you probably tonight when it comes to guarding your heart and guarding your path is this, and that is finding someone that's a little further in their relationship with Jesus than you are, that are willing to walk that path with you. And I understand that takes time, but the overall goal would be getting to the point where you can come to this place of real transparency with that person. It doesn't happen the first day, so you don't have to get all weird with that. But getting to the point where there can be real transparency. I have probably three or four people in my life that know everything there is to know about me. Something's going on in my life that shouldn't be, they know. It's one of the most encouraging things, or the most the best advice that I could give you. Honesty and transparency within yourself is huge, really, really important. Honesty and transparency with those who are walking purposefully your path with you is absolutely huge. But all of those things that we just mentioned work together when it comes to guarding your heart. They help you when it comes to the process of guarding your heart, and guarding your heart helps you in the process of guarding those other things as well. And the way that I read about it, those examples, those caricatures, the fool, the simple, and the wise, the issue is not what they've heard, right? That they've all heard this. The issue is how they've applied what it is they've heard when it comes to godly wisdom, how they've handled it, whether or not they've actually applied it. Solomon says that the wise, they're attentive to godly wisdom in their life, and they let it live deep in their hearts. Their words bring life to the people around them. They have a clear path for their feet. Their eyes are fixed on it. And they keep their heart. They protect their heart with vigilance because they know it has a lot to do with where they're going. It's a lifelong process of learning and growing. And I want you to know that I believe that journey right there, the lifelong process of learning and growing, that journey right there is actually what God desires for you most. That's what God desires to do with you most, is to walk on that path with you. Your heart is or will be under attack through temptation, through sin, through our culture. And we live in a world where guarding our heart is incredibly important. It's really, really important. Guarding our hearts with diligence from all kinds of sexual brokenness, all kinds of lies that we're tempted to believe, lies about ourselves or lies about our identity. Guarding our hearts from hate and judgment, not caring about those who are around us who may be acting like they're far from God, because get this, They actually are far from God. Not caring about those things that God desires for us. Not taking advantage of the wisdom that He has made known to us in our life. Honestly believing that maybe there's things that we know more than He knows when it comes to living with godly wisdom. I'm going to invite the worship team to come back up. I don't know, you know, where you're at when it comes to this idea of guarding your heart. And for me, you know, kind of looking through the lens of looking through the lens of the wise and the simple and the fool, like it really does kind of, it kind of helps me navigate where it is that I really am when it comes to that. And like I said, as I've kind of laid that out before myself and tried to be super transparent with the truth when it comes to me, I see parts of myself in every single category. There's room to grow, and I'm thankful for that, that I've got room to grow. But one of the things Solomon said, you know, Solomon is a guy that God came to in a dream and said, Solomon, ask for one thing, I'm going to give you whatever you want. And it says that Solomon asked for wisdom and God gave it to him. He was the wisest man that ever lived. That's the man who says, guard your heart. Because it determines the course of your life. How are you doing with that? Online, how are you doing that with your friends? How are you doing with that at work? When it comes to this idea of guarding your heart, understanding that it determines the course of your life. How are you doing? It might just be me, but it sounds huge. It sounds absolutely huge. Every Sunday, we want to offer the opportunity to have communion. It's right over here on the table that's kind of folded up on itself a little bit, but it's okay. It's still there, I promise. But every Sunday, we can participate in communion. It's something that Jesus instituted, and it reminds us of the why behind the cross. Why did the cross happen? The communion reminds us of the why behind the cross. The Bible teaches us that every single one of us have fallen short of God's standard, that we all sin. And it teaches us that the wages of sin is death. And I want you to know that when it says that the wages of sin is death, I actually believe that's what we're talking about here this evening. That one of the first things that sin attacks when it's in our life is the condition of our heart. One of the first things that sin kind of does in our life is that it attacks the condition of our heart. And just like any other relationship, once our heart is conflicted, once that's going on, it's incredibly difficult sometimes to navigate. And so Jesus did. He pretty smart man, incredibly wise. He left us communion as a way to connect with Him. And he sat down with those who were closest to Him. And He said, you know what, as often as you get together, I want you to do this, to take the bread and to take the cup and to remember the cross where I am bringing. Jesus is bringing reconciliation between a perfect and holy God and people with broken hearts. That's what communion is. And so as we sing the next couple of songs, anytime that you're ready, feel free to go and get communion. You can spread out and take it whenever you're ready over that. So over the next couple of songs. So let's pray. God, I pray that You would help us to be people who understand the wisdom in guarding our heart. God, I pray that You would help us to be the kind of people that would be vigilant in keeping our heart. That we would be mindful of our eyes and our ears and our feet and our mouth. God, when it comes to the direction of my life, I just want to say that I'm sorry for all those times that I try to pretend like I have a better understanding of that than You do. That I tend to try to take over and tell You how it's going to be. God, I just ask for Your help again in understanding what godly wisdom really looks like well applied in my life. Help us all to understand that. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Cast their crowns before the Lamb.
from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Out on me, your love, your love. Yes, it overwhelms and satisfies my soul. And I never, ever have to be afraid. This one thing remains. This one thing remains. Stand together. Oh, your love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails. It never gives up. Nothing that separate my heart from your great love. Your great love. And on it goes. Yes, it overwhelms and satisfies my soul. And I never, ever have to be afraid. Cause this one thing, it remains. This one thing, it remains. Oh, and on. And on, it never fails. Yes, it overwhelms and satisfies my soul. You are so good, and I never, ever have to be afraid. Cause this one thing remains. Oh, this one thing. Never runs out on me. Your love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love, oh, oh, your love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up,
it never runs out on me.
Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love.
God, I thank you that our hearts can be entrusted to you, that we can guard them and place them in your care because you are a good God. A father who wants to take care of his children. And God, we pray that you would be with us this week. Help us not to forget that your mercies are new every single morning. That your love does not fail. That you are slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness. That not height nor depth, not angel nor demon, nothing in all of creation can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Help us to entrust ourselves to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Y'all have a wonderful evening.